Welcome back to this week of renewable energy generation. In this video, we will discuss the theoretical potential of wind energy. In week 5, wind energy technology will be discussed in greater technical detail. This is the image most people will visualize when they think about wind energy. A large wind turbine with slowly rotating blades. The rotation of the blades is caused by the wind. But where does wind come from exactly? Again, let's start with the sun. Solar rays cause a temperature gradient on the Earth's surface. The temperature gradient can be the result of a number of factors, such as the position on the Earth with respect to the equator, the presence of clouds, the presence of large bodies of waters, and even the type of terrain. The temperature gradient induces a pressure gradient, which leads a particle flow from a high pressure to a low pressure area. This is what we experience as wind. The wind carries kinetic energy, which is converted into mechanical energy by means of a wind turbine. Next, a generator converts the mechanical energy into electrical energy. An electronic converter in combination with a transformer links the generator to the grid, ensuring maximum power. The primary energy potential of the wind is given by the mass of air traveling at a certain speed. This is called kinetic energy and is characterized by this equation. E kinetic equals half the product of the wind mass and the velocity squared. Similarly, the wind power, P wind, is calculated using the mass flow instead of the mass. The mass flow itself is equal to the product of the air density, the surface area of the rotor, and the wind velocity. By inserting this definition of the mass flow, we obtain this equation for the wind power. The power is expressed in watts, the density in kilograms per cubic meter, the area in meters, and the velocity in meters per second. This equation shows that the power is highly dependent on the wind speed. As you can imagine, the height and the surroundings of a wind turbine greatly influence the wind speed. High wind speeds are achieved at large hub heights and in close proximity to the coast. An offshore wind park will result in a higher power density in the order of 3 watts per square meters. Any obstacles that interrupt the wind flow, like houses or trees, will lower the wind speed. Also, do not forget that the wind turbines can disrupt each other's airflow. This is very important when you design a wind farm. To obtain the power output of a wind turbine, the potential power in the wind needs to be multiplied by the system's efficiencies. The terminology used for the product of all conversion efficiency is called the power coefficient. This power coefficient is the electricity produced by the wind turbine divided by the primary energy potential in the wind. This ratio includes the conversion efficiencies from kinetic energy to mechanical energy and from mechanical energy to electrical energy. The maximum theoretical conversion efficiency from the kinetic energy to the mechanical energy turning the rotor is called the Betz limit, named after Albert Betz, a German physicist. He derived this ratio the following way. Energy extracted from the wind by the turbine at A causes the wind speed to decline to V2, and the airflow behind the turbine will expand to an area as big as A2. This effect also takes place in front of the turbine. The area from which the energy can be extracted with the original wind speed of V1 is only as large as A1. So, geometrically, there is a theoretical limit of 59.3% of the energy in the wind that can be converted into mechanical energy. The energy yield of wind turbines is greatly determined by seasonal and daily intermittencies. Notably, there is more wind in the winter than in the summer. We also need to take into account that when wind speeds become too high, the wind turbine is forced to cut off in order to protect its system. Finally, just as with other systems, wind turbines will have a certain downtime due to maintenance and repairs. Let's use what we have learned so far. We'll take the Enercon E126 wind turbine as an example. It has a rotor diameter of 126 meters and a power coefficient of 0.483 at a wind speed of 10 meters per second. First of all, we need to gather the appropriate values. The density of air is 1.23 kilograms per cubic meter. Furthermore, we will assume 10 meters per second as an average yearly wind speed at the location of our Enercon turbine. Now we will only need to determine the frontal surface, which is pi times half the diameter squared. This results in approximately 12.5 times 10 to the power 3 square meters. The potential of the wind is then calculated using the wind power equation. P wind equals half times 1.23 times 12.5 times 10 to the power 6, which equals to 7.7 megawatts. The power generated by the turbine is equal to the power available in the wind multiplied by the power coefficient. In this case, 7.7 megawatt times 0.48, which equates to 3.7 megawatts. This is very close to the actual value of 3.75 megawatt in the datasheet of the Enercon wind turbine. In order to estimate the capacity factor of wind turbines, we will take a look at the country of Denmark. Denmark is a worldwide leader when it comes to wind power. Denmark produces about 42% of their electricity demand with wind power alone. In 2015, they had a total nominal capacity of 5 gigawatts, with which they produce around 14.13 terawatt hours. Then, the capacity factor is calculated by dividing the energy yield by the nominal capacity, multiplied by the time. This results in a capacity factor of 0.32 or 32%. The greatest advantage of wind power technology is the large energy potential. Wind power can provide multiple times the world's need for energy. However, wind turbines do have a relatively low capacity factor of around 0.3. Moreover, its intermittent behavior can jeopardize the grid stability. Also, even though wind turbines can be built anywhere, good wind sites are often in remote locations far away from the energy demand. Finally, let's take a quick look into the global status of wind energy. In 2016, the global nominal capacity was around 486 gigawatt, producing 960 terawatt hours of electricity. If we take a world population of 7.5 billion, we will get 351 watt hours per person per day. In terms of average power, wind energy has a surface power density of 2 to 3 watts per square meters. On our map we have used in the previous lecture, we can definitely see we need a much smaller area to power the world's electricity demand with wind energy than with hydropower. In this lecture, you learned about principles behind wind energy conversion technology. Behind the extraction of wind energy, we have seen that the wind carries kinetic energy and that the amount of energy strongly depends on the wind velocity. Furthermore, we discussed the maximum conversion efficiency and low capacity factor of wind turbines, and we thus discussed the advantages and limitations of wind energy conversion. In the next video, we will discuss a technology with an even larger potential: solar energy.